Yes, I suppose the recording is on now. Well, so let us start our brief discussion on API, the RESTful API. So REST stands for, please try to respond with your answers. No problem. You have to interact with me so that our things will be moved fast. So REST stands for, what is the abbreviation for REST? REST protocol. Representational state transfer, right? Representational state transfer, representing what you are going to represent from these words. Please try to tell me what you understand by the words representational state transfer. Just in your own meanings, please. Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so representational state transfer. REST. What do you understand with this terms, representational state transfer? Please, in your own words, I don't want the exact technical definition.
Sir, resource?
Yes, what is resource? What do you mean by resource here? What do you understand?
Resource of data.
Resource is nothing but which contains some data. Very good. So, resources. So whenever you access certain information, the information which is present on any computer on across the internet, so how do you access that? Usually we use a protocol, HTTP or HTTPS more specifically. We use this protocol HTTPS and try to retrieve the data which is present on a different computer or on a different server or on a different system which is connected over the internet. So what are the different methods that this REST protocol do support? Yes, please.
HTTP.
HTTP is a protocol. It is not a method, please. Please remember, again, I'm repeatedly saying the last class also, HTTP is a protocol which basically follows the representational state transfer, REST. It is a protocol, the set of rules.
Sir, rules. Get, put, post.
Yes, yes, yes. Get. Put, post, delete. Yeah. Of course, in the last class, I asked you to come prepared. If you remember, I have given you the material also. And I asked you to set up a web server onto the Raspberry Pi to fetch some data. So, right. So, let us, it is a continuation of that only, please. Remember, this is not very new topic which you are trying to understand. Only thing is how we are applying to the Internet of Things. That is the most crucial part here. This REST topic, I suppose you might have already learned in the internet technologies or web technologies or computer networks course, or you might have heard earlier also. So you know the basic data exchange or the information exchange through the client server model using HTTP or HTTPS with the whatever you call it as following the REST protocols. So today what we are trying to understand is how we can implement this REST API for our Internet of Things when you add new devices in the Internet of Things application. So how these devices can be accessible for us across the net or across the different networks so that you can exchange the data or you can retrieve the data or you can control the data for a particular device. You can use the data and control the device, you can manage the devices and so on and so forth using this API or application programming interface through the REST or the RESTful mechanism. So as we, let me just quickly go through. So I prepared some notes even for those people who are very new to this. So please remember, RESTful, R-E-S-T, R-E-S-T itself stands for Representational State Transfer. And this is one of the main important standard for enabling communication between the server part of a product and its client. The clients can be both web or a mobile, and or it can be any other device connected across the network. So here, so it is a standard for which enables you to have some communication between the two different entities, between the two different parts. One part is your server part, the other part is the object which can be accessing the data, or which can be basically retrieving or fetching the data on the other side of the network. So when you see in a client server architecture, that's, you know what is the meaning of a client server, the client is a person who is requesting some information, and server is the a particular object which is trying to respond to the request of the client. If the information is available at that particular place, then the information can be given as a response to that particular client, and so on and so forth, very in simple terms. So here, in order to have the communication between the client and server, you are going to set up an API. API, that is the application programming interface, which acts like a bridge that connects the client with the server. So this application programming interface, through your software, you try to provide a bridge between the client and the server so that they can have communication between each other. So that that bridge can be basically, that is basically a software. That software will help you to connect two different hardware devices, or connect between a hardware device and a software, or a software and a hardware device, vice versa. So it can be anything. It need not be simply an hardware to hardware, or it can be either way, software to hardware and hardware to software. It means you can have communication between your application to your hardware. Hardware is basically your IoT device, or from the IoT device is sending some data to your application. So either way, it is API is providing some kind of interface which basically acts like a bridge, provides the interconnection among the two different entities to have some communication between each other. So basically, whenever you try to exchange the data between client and server, there are various data formats. So means the data in what form or in what way we need to exchange the communication between those client servers. So usually you have something called as direct data formats. Direct data, it means these, whatever you are seeing, this XML, extended markup language, JavaScript object notations, YAML, so all these are basically your direct data formats, which will help you to exchange the data between your client and the server, or between your hardware devices, and it can be between your software and the hardware too. Sometimes not only using these three formats, it can be even the feed data formats, that what you see on your websites, where you get the request responses in a continuous manner. So this RSS field formats can also be used, or in a database data formats, where you can have either in your comma separated or your SQL data format to exchange the data between any two forms. So today we are seeing how this JSON can be used as a data carrier or a data format enabler for us to exchange the data between our program and the hardware device. That is basically your LED here. And I mean, before we proceed to the REST APIs, you also should understand what are uniform resource identifiers, URI. URI, URL, URN, there are different types basically. There are differences between URI and URL. So I hope you already might have seen these things, uniform resource identifier, uniform resource locator, uniform resource name, URN. So all these are basically used to whenever you are following a REST mechanism, so that they can try to help you to identify the devices which are present on your server or on a particular resource. So those resources can be easily identified by using certain notation. So the usual notation that we use for you to access the web pages, you may have seen this simple example. So https://, you provide the server name with the .com or your whatever the domain name is going to be there, followed by //, then the page and the example, where that particular example is the actual resource or the information which you are trying to retrieve, which you are trying to fetch from a particular server, from a particular resource or a particular device where it is located on a network. So this path, please understand carefully, the same path we will try to use it here, the same syntax, rather the same style of fetching the data and managing the data and controlling the data on IoT devices too. So of course, the domain names remains the same, but here basically the resources, it will not be your web pages, please remember. So in simple terms, if you compare with your IoT API and our usual web pages, so what you are trying to do in the web resources fetching is, you are trying to fetch the web pages like your .html files or your .xml files or your .json files. Sometimes your data files also can be retrieved. So here, this basically at the last in the path, whatever you see the path at the last point, what you specify the end point, we call it as an end point. That is the example what you see. It can be a web page or it can be any other object also which you try to retrieve from the server. So this is the actually the basically the syntax or the what is the common way of trying to address the corresponding resources that are located on a server, and you are trying to access them from another place on the internet. So this is one thing that we need to understand, just a recollection of those things. So you should know how to give the what are the rules to be followed when you are specifying. So underscores has to be avoided. Please remember, please avoid underscores. You better go for the hyphens. Usually in the URLs, you see these hyphens, and most probably most of the time you will not see the underscores. See, can may I know the reason why in the URLs usually you will find the hyphens, not the underscores? Just for your curiosity, I'm trying to ask here.
Sir, your screen is not visible, I think. Are you sorry? Presenting, sir? There is another screen, so.
Deepak Kumar, yes, again, I'm telling you, all of you, there are three screens on today's session, please. Please verify whether there are three screens with my name. One screen is with the Raspberry Pi and LED connected. Another screen with a program which is showing, and another screen. Another screen with my notes which I'm presenting right now.
No, that note screen is not visible. It is your face.
Okay, then I'll just stop my Raspberry Pi screen and
try to. No, now it's invisible.
Okay, so fine. Just please, indicate me whenever you are having such a problem. No problem. I can, no worries. I can just respond to you. So, are you able to see this notes? What I'm trying to show to you?
Yes.
This notes anyway. I will try to upload it on the Moodle screen. Since there are already multiple screens are there, I will just share it whenever I'm trying to present this one. So this what I'm trying to say here is, we are understanding what is a RESTful API. You already know what is a REST APIs are, how the data is to be exchanged between the two objects or two entities, that is your client and the server. You can have direct data formats, feed data formats, database data formats, so on and so forth. Then you can see how the URLs have to be given. So usually URL is going to have your https/ the domain name followed by the path which contains where the data has to be fetched from a particular resource. Usually it will be web pages. So far you may have practiced using web pages. Now instead of these web pages, you will be accessing the hardware device, the pins of the hardware device. So that's what our IoT difference comes here. So you need to follow certain notations when you are specifying the URLs. So usually you need to avoid the underscores. You need to specify the hyphens and all. So these points are just for your remembrance. So now let us move on to endpoints. What are called endpoints when you're using the REST APIs? Yes, please. What are called endpoints in the RESTful API? Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir. Endpoint means the URLs which we.
Yes, see here. Now you see this basically a URL. In this URL, or you can say indicator, uniform resource indicator. So this endpoint will specify the resource, basically the resources that you need to fetch the data. So these endpoints will be coming, basically they are endpoints are meant for accessing your resources. The resource can be a web page, the resource can be hardware device like an IoT device. Please remember that. So those resources are located at some point, at some particular server, at some particular device, and you are trying to access those resources. So your endpoints can be accessed. Your endpoints can be accessed with various methods. So those are your your standard REST methods. You know what is a get, put, post, delete. So what happens when you use a get method? in the HTTP?
We send parameters along with the URL to the in the request.
You get response from the web server. The web server is going to give the web pages. So whenever you type http://uhyd.ac.in, your HTTP is trying to get the data from a particular server. So that response from the server is basically you are going to get the responses only when you are using either your get or your use when you are using the post methods. So what is the difference between put? What does the put method do? Okay, I will not ask the difference. At least tell me, what does the put method do when you are using HTTP put method?
Sir, update the data.
Yes, it will update the data and it will be persisting. Please remember, it will be persisting. You cannot change the data again. So please remember, that is one thing. So obviously, when you use the delete command, it is going to delete the resources on that particular server. So if you are sending a delete command, usually with the HTTP. So now if you see a simple example here, get a photo from a particular resource, from a particular database, you can delete a particular photo on a photo which is located in the photos folder. So you are going to post a picture onto the server. You are going to put your use the put method to put a photo, and you are going to get the resources like a photo from the photos folder from a particular server. So these are the basic methods, please remember. Apart from these basic methods, get, delete, post, put, and get, you have some other methods too. Can you please tell me another method name which can be used to do some temporary
update, sir?
Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please tell me, apart from this get, delete, post,
update.
Update, okay, since I not mentioned here, I do accept, but I'm looking for something. Update is basically your put method, which tries to update it. But the difference between put and update, there is a minute difference is there. But I'm looking for something which it's a put method will always will make the data to be persistent, in the sense that it is going to make it permanent. You cannot change the data. But if you want to make some intermediate changes or temporary changes on a particular web resource or on a particular hardware device, you have to use another method name called as, any idea? Okay, you might have heard. That's called as patch.
Patch?
Yeah, yes, patch. P-A-T-C-H. Yes, very good. 2-3 students have responded. Very good. The patch method. So today we'll see how that patch method also can be used along with the other methods. So of course, whenever you are using this RESTful APIs, you also should take care of your HTTP and HTTPS. Basically, HTTPS, you know what is it? S stands for having the security. So that whenever you are doing some client-server communication, that HTTPS will always guide you, will help you to have a secure data transmissions and so on and so forth. And not only this, scalability is another important thing where more number of requests do come to your server. So that server should be capable enough to hold or to able to serve many number of requests, and it should be flexible to add more resources very easily. So these are the basic steps I call it as are features which everybody should know. I have an understanding what a RESTful mechanism is and how do we implement it. So let us now see how to implement the RESTful APIs on a Raspberry Pi. Since Raspberry Pi is one of your gateway device or your IoT device, which will help you to have fetching the data and transmit the data across the various devices or across the applications. So we'll take a small example on understanding how do you establish or how do you set up an API application programming interface using Raspberry Pi. So here, as I mentioned in the last class, whenever you are trying to access or manage or control some data through internet or through remotely, some server has to be running on the devices. So always you are going to make use of the server. The name itself tells you, the client server mechanism. So there must be a server at one of the place where you are going to have some resourceful objects, resourceful information. From that server, you are trying to access the data and get the data, or you try to do some data processing and so on and so forth. So here the example what I'm trying to today present is on a Flask server. So you might have heard so far server like Apache. So what does an Apache server is meant for? Can anybody tell me?
Web server.
Yeah, Apache server is basically either your LAMP or a WAMP or a MAMP or whatever it may be. Basically, it is a web server. Apache, of course, Apache, there are other different types of servers are there which follows the Apache. So Apache is one particular server which you already might have very much familiar. So there, so just keep in mind, let us come back to that Apache later. So along not only Apache, you have seen some other servers too in the internet technologies courses or your web technologies. You might have seen the Node.js server. So what does a Node.js server do, or what is the purpose of a Node.js server? So I'm just giving some names of the servers for you to recollect it. Node.js server, what does a Node.js server do? What is the advantage of a Node.js server? Why there are so many servers are there, at least? I will put the question in very generic way so that at least you can answer.
Sir, like basically a server provides an IP to a device, and that device can be accessed from anywhere through these methods.
Yes, server is basically a server. Server is meant for to serve some request, very in simple terms. Anybody can understand this terminology. A server is a person who is going to serve your request. So I am naming some servers. You please see here Apache, Node.js, IIS, IIS, Internet Information Server, IIS. Similarly, you have, now you are going to see a Flask. So I have given you four different types of servers. So can you tell me why those different, what is the purpose of having different servers? Why not only one or two or three? If you look into the internet, you will see hundreds of servers. In fact, you can also write your own server program and you can give a name.
Sir, Node.js is known for serving like many requests per second, like being
why Apache server cannot serve many requests per second?
No, sir, like that number is considerably high, sir, than Apache.
Considerably high because many requests can be served, you mean to say? Many requests can be served.
Many requests, sir.
Sir, basically, like the language in which we can communicate with the server varies, sir. Like that's why we have these many, like Django and Flask use Python.
Yes, Django is another one. Is another framework, actually. In fact, framework. Even this Flask is also one framework. Apache, people use the term server frameworks interchangeably depending on the context of their application usage. So do not confuse about the term called framework or the term server. So there are basically, they are the interchangeable words. So okay, of course, the both the Bharadwaj have given the answer in a right context, but I am just expecting some the basic difference still. This can be one of the different, the number of requests, and based on the application programming language, what you use different server. Yes, that's true, actually. Yes, there are so many, plenty of differences do come here because each, yeah, somebody is trying to say, yes, please.
So, and one more difference is like how big the server is. Like Flask, coming to Flask, it's a lightweight framework, and Django, it's a bit heavy and it's slow to load sometimes.
Okay, again, you are also on that track. Still a little bit, if you further narrow down, Anurag, you can get the right answer. What I mean to say is, I'll give the answer. Let me just, okay, please. See here, all these servers, of course, they are meant for different applications, different context in which they are going to use different programming languages, different number of requests, and so on and so forth. But if you see the basic difference from my perspective, I'm telling you, it can be from your perspective also. Basically, it is nothing but the number of libraries, the number of features. Those libraries makes it as a lightweight or it as a heavyweight, like what your Anurag is telling. Flask is a lightweight, whereas the Django is basically is a heavyweight, sometimes slow, or what your Bharadwaj is telling, the number of requests coming from different users across the network, That will be Node.js serves more requests, more responses can be done. Similarly, like this, the basic philosophy behind all this behind your answers is nothing but basically those frameworks has got number of libraries. In fact, number of libraries are going to be different. So Node.js libraries are different from Apache libraries. Apache libraries are different. Means it is there. The library is basically the core of that server. The server processing core capabilities are different. In fact, so when the web technologies have come, so usually the web technology in the early 2000, means in the 2000 to 2005, during that time, Microsoft IIS, Internet Information Server, and Apache, these are the only two servers we used to be having. Later, so many other servers have again evolved, and depending on their application context, if you want to have your own application to be running and in the Internet of Things, you can also put your own server, please. Means you can give a new server name and you can put the corresponding libraries only, so that libraries only are going to be useful for that application, so that the extra functionalities are not required for everything. But when you see, when you install an Apache, that Apache's web server is able to install the PHP parsing engine, the Z engine, as well as the database engines. Like this, it is by default, it is supporting there. So sometimes you may not require database server to be connected to your web server or to another server. So it all depends on the application context, where you are trying to use it and where you are trying to integrate different types of servers, web servers, database servers, performance management servers, and basically accessing the data, simply accessing the resources. All this all depends on the application in which you are going to use, and accordingly that server has to be used. That's why people have come out with so many different number of servers for different purposes. So while you are studying, you should also have exposure to different servers, so that you can see the differences when you try to do the experimentation. That is the main thing that you need to do during this stage. So, but later when you go to the industry, obviously, you, depending on the application, depending on the project, depending on the requirements of the software project which you are going to do, you need to look onto the different servers and try to establish and use them accordingly. So, okay, now this particular example, what we are trying to see, a server is a Flask server, which is very lightweight framework, which is based on the Python, a Python framework. So a Python framework, which is very lightweight, does not have many libraries such as other Zend engine, the PHP parsing, the other parsers to be integrated. So even it does not have the database server too. Database server is not there. Even your Zend engine, the parsing, the PHP parsing engine is also not there as compared to your Apache. Then what is there in this Flask? Can anybody tell me? This Flask server does not have any data support, does not have any support to the database as well as to your web servers, parsers to be included. Then what does this server? This also you call it as a server only. It also serves your request. But what does this have then, apart from those? Whereas your Node.js servers do support your MySQL database. The Node.js servers do support your other Python frameworks as well as TensorFlow, Google's TensorFlow frameworks, and so on and so forth. So Node.js has got that capability. So like this, different servers do support different functionalities, but this Flask server does not have support to database, nor it does not have support to your parsers for your web pages or for your applications. So it is basically WSGI. Can you tell me what is WSGI stands for? Hello, am I audible to you, please?
Web Service Gateway Interface.
Yes, this is Web Services Gateway Interface. This Flask server, it supports only web services and gateway interface. Basically, our services, what service do you require? What service do you require, please? What services do we require?
Switching on the light and
Yes, of course. Switching on the light is nothing but you are going to send a command to the hardware device. Sending a command is a request. Are you getting point? Switching light on, off, or you are going to measure the temperature in a particular room from the temperature sensor or humidity. So getting the information, you can put the information, you can control the devices and so forth. So what I'm trying to say here is this Flask service, basically this Flask server do supports only you are going to see web services, you are going to get, put, post, delete. This gateway interfaces only you are very much focused and your requirement is there. For this, you doesn't require Apache. For that, you doesn't require Node.js. For that, it doesn't require Django. Are you getting this point? So please understand here the server, why we consider the Flask here. Yes, no doubt. It is sure you can have Apache for your RESTful API. You can have Node.js. You can have Django also. There is no wrong in that. But the purpose, the performance will be degraded, and it is no requirement. That technology is not required at all. Why? Because your requirement is to have services like getting, putting some values, posting and deleting and updating, and your basic things that needs the web services, just commands which are going to be sent through your HTTP using that HTTP protocol. For that, you don't require a web server. For that, you don't require a database server. For that, you don't require a Xen engine. For that, you don't require. So this the engine here on the Flask server is different from the Apache, the Xen engines and so on. Engine means a program which is processing the web request and the responses. So here, that's why we prefer to have a Flask server. I hope you are getting the point, please.
Yes, sir.
Are you able to understand my points here? I don't want to give a line by line meaning. I will try to give the overall meaning, and as well as you try to understand the purpose of that. That is enough for you at this moment. So otherwise, you need to land up in so many technologies, so many tech information that will make confusion for you a lot. So, but please be focused on the listening so that every point is also important that you need to get clarity. If you're not clear, please let me know. I'll repeat it. Otherwise, I'll be moving forward. Okay, now see here carefully. So we are moving forward. You are using a Flask server, a Python server for the web services gateways interface that will enable us to send and get the responses very easily on the server which is installed. And it is very lightweight. It doesn't require much space. Please remember IoT devices are resource constrained devices. Resource constraint means the processor and the memory is also very, very less as compared to desktop systems, laptop systems, and all. So IoT systems does not require very heavyweight servers when they are going to run on the gateways. Please remember, that is the ideal way. Yes, for practice and for understanding purpose, you can install Apache server on the Raspberry Pi. You can install Node.js server on the Raspberry Pi. You can install your Django also on the Raspberry Pi. But that will not serve our IoT purposes. IoT applications, because the memory as well as the resources are very much constrained. Resources mean the basic resources like processor, memory, and your storage devices. We prefer for a lightweight applications always. So lightweight servers, lightweight applications are most preferable on your IoT devices. Please remember this point. So now coming to this as a lightweight server, we install the lightweight server, and of course we follow. So now the resources, for our application, for our experimentation here is, the resources are our pins. What are pins? These pins are nothing but your general purpose I/O pins of your Raspberry Pi. So we are going to directly communicate to the Raspberry Pi pins, exchange the data. Means you send a command, what needs to be done with that pin. Either you can on and off. For understanding, we are just looking for this LED on and off. But the basic funda, the philosophy is what is this particular experimentation will give you. You can further explore more, like getting the temperature, humidity, which is also connected to another pin. So you, there are so many things that you can do it. So now the example here is, you can directly interact with the GPIO pins. So the resources for us, this basically the resource endpoints for in our case is not is our GPIO pins. You can interact with Pi camera. If your camera, Pi camera is connected to your Raspberry Pi, you can interact with your USB ports of your Raspberry Pi. You can interact with your memory card of your Raspberry Pi. You can interact with other Ethernet card if you are connecting. So if you are connecting an Arduino board to the Raspberry Pi also, you can interact with that. So like that, our resource in this experimentation, our resource endpoints are GPIO pins. To one of the GPIO pins, we will interface, means we will write a program how we can interface with the GPIO pins and interact with the GPIO pins for exchange of information. So before we try to write the programs and all, let me understand the design steps. The very, very important design steps, you need to prepare your resource, the pin resource. So what is the resource model? Model means you need to specify how you can access your pin. What are all the things that are required for you to interact with the pin? So when you are interacting with the pin, your JSON model, obviously you know what is a JSON is. So basically it is a key, it is a key value pair. You can see the attribute is this ID, and the value is nothing but the corresponding value is just been given after the colon symbol. So this key value pair will tell us what are all the attributes or what are all the keys that are to be considered for our pin resource. So very simple things here. One is we are having the ID. We are giving an ID number to the pin. So this basically is their identifier, a unique identifier. And of course, this ID is different from the pin number. The pin number is basically corresponds to the GPIO. Why we need two IDs here? Already a pin number, GPIO pin is itself is unique number. Yes, I do accept that one. But this ID is meant for you to interact with many other, if there are many other Raspberry Pis and many other objects which you are trying to indicate. So for every object or for every pin of the GPIO, you are also giving a specific ID number. So that is will be very much unique. If your GPIO pin of another Raspberry Pi is been connected as a master child with another Raspberry Pi, either in a cluster or in the other distributed environment, then this pin number is going to give a conflicts for us. So here, that's why we give an ID number, a unique ID number for every pin of that GPIO also, so that it will be unique to identify that corresponding pin. And of course, since we are connecting LEDs to the pins of GPIO pins, so we are looking for what type of color LED are we going to give to that pin. So either you can give a red color, green color, blue, yellow, different types of colors and different objects, so that you can have a distinction between each pin and interface it easily. Along with this, you need another important key attribute or a key. Then nothing but the state which is representing, that's what the representational state transfer. So the state here is that pin will make the LED on and off. So when you are making on and off, on is one state, off is another state. So that's why we need to have these four at least the minimum things that will be the basic things that needs to be used for our exchange of information between the software and the hardware, that is your GPIO pin. So these are the model that we need to prepare ourselves. So in the design stage, so whenever you are building an API, please remember the first step, the first stage. Yes, not only that, first stage is to have your model. Model means the data model in which you need to exchange the data, in the format in which you need to send and receive the data. So that model design is important. That is the first step. And what are all the things that needs for in this particular API modeling? Already I given these informations. So please refer to these basic principles of REST API, REST mechanisms, then followed by how do we build an API for our Raspberry Pi we are discussing here. Now coming to the HTTP verbs, these are the action verbs. What are the action verbs for our HTTP protocol or for our REST mechanism? The action verbs. Action verbs means action, something to be done. So basically, you need to create a pin, or you can read the data, you can get the data, you can put the data. So you can fetch the data. That is what get. Get is one verb. Verb means your action thing that needs to be done. So you can fetch the data. So you can specify that something like this. Get what is the data for the pin. Pin number 24, what is its ID, what is its color, what is its state, you can get the data. You can use the put verb also, put. So when you use the put command, you can see for so-and-so pins along with the ID, you can say that you can update that particular state information of that particular pin. So you can use the put command. Similarly, you can use the delete command. So delete command, you know what happens with delete command. Obviously, the entire the state of the pin state information is completely deleted. So please don't use the delete command while you are practicing it, so that it will not make it difficult for others when they are practicing on the Raspberry Pi when you are using this part for our understanding. So just for our completeness, I am giving this delete operation also, so you can have an idea. But not apply this delete method onto this Raspberry Pi pin. Please remember that. Okay, now let us see. This is a patch. This is a patch is another verb, action verb of the REST mechanism, RESTful mechanism that is using HTTP. You can use the patch command also. This is partially updates the pin with whatever the resource ID you try to specify. So obviously, you also should know the status codes. So what are all the different status codes piece of HTTPs? Can you please recollect it? The status codes of 200, the status codes of 300, the status codes of 400, the status codes of 500. So not just only simply 200, 300, 400, 500. You will have 505, you will have 404, you will have 202, you will have 203. So different status codes codes are there available for every HTTP. So I will not just bore you up all the status codes. It itself will take 1 hour time. So let us now see here the board setup. So I'm just coming directly to the practical part so you can understand the program also, how do we write it. So what we are using two, three LEDs, red LEDs are there. But for our experimentation, I just connected one LED. Of course, one resistor you need to have, and one breadboard and one GPIO connecting cable. So the command that I'm, the state information I'm specifying is the pin number, GPIO pin number 21, color red is being specified for us. So you can see it on, so let me just stop presenting here so that you can see this, the connections. Once I see the connections, we'll go to the program. So can you see the Raspberry Pi here? Can you see the Raspberry Pi connected to the LED? So very yes, simple sir. Connection here on the breadboard. What I connected is one, this is a LED, red LED. Of course, I connected to GPIO pin number 21. So GPIO pin number 21. So this is the breadboard which is already having the DHT. So you can see the DHT sensor which is already running on this Raspberry Pi. And this is LED, and of course one resistor, 220 ohms resistor I connected here, which can be anything more than 100, that is enough for you. And this LED is connected to the Raspberry Pi. Okay, are you able to see that connection here, Raspberry Pi?
Yes, sir.
Right. So now, can you see the program which is running on this Raspberry Pi on the other screen? Which I'm. Are you able to see the program?
Yes. Shall I,
can you see the program? Please let me know. Others, if you are having difficulty, because it's already in the presentation mode.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So let me. Please tell me what is actually happening here, what I am going to do.
Start the Flask servers.
No, I am not starting the Flask server, just hold on. Okay, now tell me what command are you able to see.
Python 3 DHT Python.
Yes, this is a program. If you see earlier we are running, earlier we have run this one. And how to get the temperature and the humidity values. Something has stuck for me here. So the same program, I'll get back to you later. Let me just see this program here. So what we are trying to do here is, so here in order to set up this we have certain requirements on the Python. Can you see the list of the dependencies for the program to be installed on the Raspberry Pi?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So we have a. I'm using a Flask REST plus API along with the Flask. So this REST plus API will help us to use this get, put, and delete and the patch methods very easily. Along with this, of course, we are using the JSON schema. We are using it, and you are using the request and the RPI GPIO packages. So these are the basic packages that it will be getting installed within just a couple of minutes. If you are trying to do it on your own laptop, on your own Raspberry Pi, then that is be fine. Just within 2-3 minutes, that gets installed. So once it is installed, let us write the program here. Okay, before writing the program, let me show you the execution part. Once you see the execution part, you'll be able to understand it. Then we'll come back to the program explanation. I tell you what are all the things that you need to do. It's going to be very simple only. All right. Can you see there are two screens on my Raspberry Pi?
Yes, sir.
Right, so I have typed one command on one particular window. So what exactly happened on one window when I typed that command? Can you see? Please let me know what you are able to see on this, what you observe.
Flask server is running on 5000 ports.
Yes, very good. So here I am explaining to you all, please see here carefully what happened is one server is running now in the background. That's why that is called as a server. So server is going to serve this request. So what you see here is serving Flask. What is the name of that app? What is the name of the app that I have written here?
App.
Sorry? Yes, APP. APP itself is the app name here. So this is since a sample example, I'm using the same name. So this Flask app is now started. And of course, this is in the development server. Do not use it for your production development. That's what there's a warning here. So for development for learning purpose, you can use it and use a production WSGI. What is the WSGI stands for? Just now I told you.
Web server gateway interface.
Very good. Web server gateway interface. Web server gateway interface. Very lightweight Python framework just to have our web services, basic web services. So now, of course, debug mode is on. Now running on what? Running on the IP address. So what is that IP address here is? Just I want to make sure that you are able to see that command.
Local
that's the instruction.
Local
that's all. Host. Local host. That is 127.0.0.1. Is the port number? What is the port number?
5000.
So remember, you can run your Apache server parallelly also. In fact, already there is a LAMP stack in the same Raspberry Pi. Can you remember it? Already we have installed a LAMP server. That's why you are in the MySQL server is also been installed there. If you remember, the DHT values are going to be installed on the database server. So here I'm running two servers actually, in fact, on the Raspberry Pi. One is on with Flask and as well as with the Apache. Okay, now let us see. So this is active. This program, now the server is active, it is running in the background. So once you started your server, so I'm opening in another window here. So on the other another window, can you see the command what I typed here? What command did I type, please?
Curl.
Curl. What does curl command stands for? CURL stands for what? In internet technologies, you already learned this one. CURL. URL. URL. In before URL, what did you type? C. CURL. command URL. You are typing the URL at the command prompt. Please remember. So what is the URL I'm typing here?
Localhost colon 5000 pins /1/1.
So here I'm typing something. This is the URL. And what is the method name I'm using here? The HTTP method?
So patch.
The patch command. Yes, patch command. So you know, you might have seen get, you might have seen put, you might have seen delete, or you might have seen post and so on. Now you are seeing another command called patch. So what is the patch command used for? Already I given something information while I'm presenting it just before. Patch command is used for what?
It's a partial update.
Yes, partial update. Very good. Good observations, good listening. Now coming to this. So what is the command I have given here? So I'm writing a command. This command is basically, you are going to set the command. So the pin number. So pin number is what is the pin ID? The ID. ID of the pin is 1. And I'm typing content type. The content type is basically application/JSON, the JSON file, the JSON format command, the data format, the data exchange. The data exchange, the data that is getting exchanged is the JSON. And in the JSON data exchange, I have given a value of to which particular key item? Of is given to which particular item, please? Of value is given to a key attribute, which one?
State.
State. So what are the other key attributes of this JSON model?
Color.
ID, color.
Yes, ID, pin. Color,
pin,
number,
pin number, and state. These are the four. Just now, before the presentation, this experimentation, I have shown you. These are JSON model contains four key values, four key attributes. One is ID, another is pin number, another is color, and the last one, state. These are the four key values. Among these four key values, I am giving only a value of to the state. So by default, it will be off only. By default, it is off. Anyway, just for execution, I have just entered the command. I'm now executing it. Have you seen the execution here? Press enter command, what happened is, actually that response, that request has come to the server. Have you observed the server request? Please see on the left hand side also, there is a server request coming. Patch /pin/1 HTTP 1.1 with the status code. What is the status code?
200.
So I entered the command from another window. So that request has come here. So now let me make the same. Let me have the instruction. The instruction is changed to what now?
On.
Can you tell me?
On.
Yes, I have changed from off state to on state. Are you getting this point? Now please observe on the left hand side. The same. Because the left hand side gets the server actually. So already now you see the LED is also on. Are you able to see the LED? Are you able to see the instruction on the server? Yeah. So I have sent. Now this is the API command. That's the API command which I have written. Now once again I'm just making it to off. See here. I'm making the on state. It is in the on state. The server also responded with the 200 status code. That's why the 200 status code implies that the LED is on here. Now I am sending off state here. Can you see on the right side of my screen? I just changed the state to off.
Yes.
Hello. Yes, please. Yeah. Oh, no, please observe the LED also. I'm just pressing the enter. 1, 2, 3. Can you see the response, the time also, at the time, how much time it has responded within. It is less than a millisecond, actually, in fact. Immediately, even the LED is also off. So this is the API command. This is the API method that you are running here. But to run this method, what are all the things required? So let us see the program here. Are you able to understand this API call? This is an API call which you are running from the command prompt only. If you have to run it from the browser, can you run it from the browser? Yes or no?
Yes, sir, we can run it on the browser. This is an API call.
Yes, this is an API call and you can run it on the browser. Can you run it from a particular domain name?
No, sir, it is on localhost.
Yeah, at present, it is on the localhost. But if you can make your server with a domain name, you can access from anywhere in the world. And you can control this LED. You can make on and off if I provide this one. Now, okay, let me explain the program and I will give access to you from your computer. You can on and off these LEDs remotely. That I will tell you. And you can prepare, how do you go with the domain name? That I will tell you in the end of the presentation. So have you able to understand just in this demo, the API call execution? Of course, this to write this API, the program has to be written. So the API call is, you are running a URL command from the command prompt with the patch method for the URL. The URL here is the localhost, because the server is running as a localhost here with the port number 5000. And the path is basically your /pins/1. One indicates the identifier, pin identifier. It is not the GPIO pin number. Please remember, GPIO pin number is different from pin identifier. So I am now accessing this particular and the endpoint, the resource, the GPIO pin identifier, I'm accessing it. And I am making the key attribute of that JSON format data, which is having to on and off. That is a demo that you have seen just now. So once again, I'm showing you on and off. Can you just see? Then I'll get back to the program and you can run it from your side also. So this is on, yes, and this is off. So let me just open the program. I'll just minimize the screen and I'll explain to you the program here. So I'm just stopping the server here now. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir.
So this is a program, the Flask program. Can you, yes, are you able, sir, to see the screen, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the first client, of course, this is the first client. You are using the Flask server and you are going to create the name of the app as app here. So that app object, that is the object which you created with this Flask server, that object is given to your API with the version number, the title, the description, and the documentation. Remember, the API documentation is the most crucial part, always. I will get back to this documentation, why this documentation is needed for you. And also the version number. The version number is almost very much important. Can you tell me why version numbers play a crucial role in the API developments or in the API usages or API buildings? You might have already seen so many software packages when you are trying to download. Please remember, the software packages, when you're downloading, the version numbers plays a crucial role. See, version numbers are always indicates that the number of features. So the latest version will have advanced features, there is no doubt. But if you're looking for an older version, then whatever the features you're looking for, you need to look for that version number. So version numbers do imply some versions will have some features, the other versions will have other features. So depending on your requirements, you choose the version number. So in this example, always, because this is just the first version of the app, we start with the 1.0. Of course, for numbering, you can give your own numbers. That is not a problem. But always, as a developer, you start with these numbers. And if you keep on, for this version number, these are the methods that you define. These are the class and the corresponding methods that you define that you are going to use it in the program. That's why we always start with this. The version is version attribute plays a vital role in the API development, please remember. So once you create an API with this app object, then you are giving the namespace. So what is the routing process, the resources that are need to be routed or the resources that are to be accessed? So you are accessing the resources such as pins. So that is what you are giving. That is a namespace which you are going to use it for your URL. So you are specifying, this is the, I'm always going to use the pins. So of course, if you're using Pi camera, if you're using a USB port, if you're using any other peripheral device connected to the Raspberry Pi, then you can use it accordingly. But so as of now, we are using in this example to start with, we are using one example with the pins of the Raspberry Pi. So you create a pins folder or a pins path for you to in the URL namespace. So that's why you say api.namespace with the pins, the related operations that you specify with the pins. And here, so the model, the JSON model, what I already mentioned to you, this is a JSON model which you are going to specify here. ID indicates the unique identifier of the Raspberry Pi pin for that particular model, pin model. Then pin number is nothing but the GPIO pin and the color and the state. So this is what your pins model contains. The API, this is the simple API model of the pins is described with this corresponding key value pairs. So once the pin model is designed, this can be used in our program for our operations purpose. So we write a class called pin util. So pin utilizations, and this pin utilization, you can see this pin utilizations. Initially, we are starting with the array, the number of pins is no pins at all. Then you are going to define your own methods. This is a Python program basically. So the what are the methods that we defined here? These methods are basically your HTTP methods. So what is the first method that you use it here, please? The cursor pointer is pointing to something. Method. So what is the first method?
Okay.
Hello? Get method. So you are defining the get method, what get method should do. So you, what is that get method will implies? So getting the information of that particular pin. So you are accessing the pins with identifier ID. ID is the identifier. Please remember, that's why I have given you slash pins. If you remember this command, so the command what I have given you here in the previous window, one second. So in the previous window, if you see here in the command, what I have given along with the server address I am given pins slash one. So if you remember in this command, pins slash one, the pins is the particular resources and to which particular pin I am trying to address, I'm giving the identifier here. So that's what here is given the pin number. So you need to specify the pin ID always. So okay, to what are the different methods that can be applied on these pins? One is your get method. So for pin in the array pin self pins, you what if it is the ID which is going to match, it is going to exist. If you are the pin number that you identifier you supplied is not existing in your model, then obviously you say that 404, that corresponding pin does not exist. So that's what your API is going to respond, that get the response. After get method, then obviously you are trying to use the create method to create the number of pins and the pins with the corresponding states. By default, it will be off state. Off state means the GPIO pins are going to be in the low state. And if it is on state, the GPIO pins are going to be in the high state. So once you create the pins with the corresponding states, you need, sometimes you can update it. This is the function for the update with the corresponding thing. This is the function for your delete. Then obviously, then you are specifying the namespace. The namespace is specified to the route. So your namespace, NS is nothing but your slash pins namespace is always using the separator, that is a forward slash separator as a namespace. So your pins slash, you can access those corresponding IDs with your pins slash. That is what you are specifying here. And you are going to show this the Marshall listings of all the pins. It means the list of all available pins. And these are the just steps that namespacings has to be done for every pin. So once you specify the namespaces and you just try to ascertain those things, then you specify the route, how the route should be specified. So slash pins slash the ID. ID, what your ID, the pin identifier that you are specifying. And if that is not present, you can provide the default response of the namespace as pin not found. And if that ID is already specified, then you specify the what is the ID and you send the request to your server. Once you have done this one, the pin resources, the marshallings have been completed. You set the GPIO and you create the pin utility function object. And with the pin utility, you create whatever the pin that you are now connected to. So I have connected the GPIO pin number 21 with the LED color and the default state as off. So what is this GPIO pin number 21, which is basically relating to the pin number Raspberry Pi, which particular Raspberry Pi pin it is? GPIO 21 is mapped to which pin of the Raspberry Pi? Please don't confuse between GPIO pins and the Raspberry Pi pins. Raspberry Pi is how many pin How many pins are there on the Raspberry Pi?
40.
40. So GPIO 21 maps to which particular pin?
BCM 21
on the Raspberry. ECM is the board. But ECM is the 21 is the GPIO only. But actually GPIO, if you see the Raspberry Pi 3, what is that GPIO 21 is mapped to which particular pin number of Raspberry Pi? GPIO.BCM. BCM is the board. So already we are using this Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi 1 is different. Raspberry Pi 2, 3, 4 are different. Please remember. Raspberry Pi 0 is different, Raspberry Pi 1 is different, and after Raspberry Pi 1, Raspberry Pi 2, 3, 4 all follows the same board. Board is going to be there, but the features are going to be a little bit different on 2, 3, 4. So compared to Raspberry Pi 0, Pi 0W we call it as, that is a model number. 0W, Raspberry Pi 1, then Raspberry Pi 2, 3, 4. 2, 3, 4 will have the same board configuration, board, the circuit board, the pins. The number of pins, GPIO pins on all these boards are going to be the same number. So those boards do not confuse, but that BCM indicates basically the Raspberry Pi 3. So the four, from four again, the advanced features are there. So you need to get into the technical more details that you can get it in a later stage. But this BCM 3 indicates the Raspberry Pi board. So yes, are you able to see it? GPIO 21 is mapped to which particular pin number?
40.
Very good. At least you are able to get it back. Good. So this is a simple program that you write your API, just an API model. So you are connecting your pins using your API Flask server to the pins, and you are accessing that GPIO pins of the Raspberry Pi remotely, and you are going to control it like this. Now you have integrated your Raspberry Pi. The device Raspberry Pi is integrated into your IoT application. So using APIs, you can easily integrate your device. So now let me just ask you to connect to the Raspberry Pi and connect from your side now. Can you, anybody can volunteer so that I can just tell in the steps, how do you access it remotely? It is not very difficult also.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Bharadwaj. Okay, can you go to your presentation mode so that I can see the steps you are doing and I can guide you how to move forward?
Okay.
Yes, please. Yeah, now Bharadwaj is connected. Good, fine. So now, okay. So your screen is little bit very okay. Look, so go to browser. Yeah, go to a new tab. Yes. So find the IP address of this Raspberry Pi. How do you get the IP address of this Raspberry Pi? The DHT sensor which is connected. You are not done practice earlier? Okay, go to ngRock. I told you ngRock, if you remember ngRock.com.
Yes, yes.
Go to ngRock.com and log in with my credentials, and you try to get the IP address from there. And using PuTTY, you should be able to connect to this Raspberry Pi, right? So log in with my credentials.
Yes, sir.
Do you have my credentials with you?
Sir, it's in the groups.
Yeah. Yes, so are you retrieving now?
Yes, sir. I have.
Yeah. Please step. Yes. I think the password is wrong.
So this is the
one more time.
You're logging in, yes. Okay, first go. Now you see here endpoint. See, this is the same name, endpoints again. So that's why this is a very very big word, endpoints. Endpoints is always will come. This name will come for any web pages, web resources, and for your hardware devices. So you are now connecting to the Raspberry Pi actually. Yes. Now go to that status. Yes. So yes. Now yes. Most likely yes. It will be yeah. Go to PuTTY.
Yes, sir.
Do you have PuTTY on your system?
I recently uninstalled it, sir. One second.
Are you able to install it? No, not yet.
Yes.
If anybody is connecting, just hold on for a couple of minutes. You can try it. Just let me complete from here the demonstration. So others, I think already some of you are already connecting to that Raspberry Pi. I can see that. Of course, the server is not running. The flash server is not running. So don't try now at this moment. Just hold on for a couple of minutes. Yeah, now you just specify the yes. Most likely, I think it is be 8.tcp. I think 8.tcp.ngrok.io. In the port number, you give 1290990. Yeah, press OK. Now press open. We just please try for the 2.tcp then.
Yes.
A port number is different. You are not typed the port number.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Connect. Yes. Yeah. Login is PI and the password is same thing.
CIS NK 99 or 999, sir.
You should know it. Even I don't remember.
It's that's why I got confused, sir. The NGROC has 999 and this one has 999.
Okay. So yes, now you can start the server now. Go to CD. RESTful app. Press enter. Now start the app. How do you start the app? No need. Python 3. Space. Yes, press enter. Yes, now the Flask server is running. Now open a new tab from that. New tab. How do you open? Put your mouse pointer top. Put in new terminal. Open a new terminal from there. Yes. Right click it. Yes.
Duplicate sessions.
No need to duplicate, Amma. Session duplicate is not required. Just you need a pro. Again, don't need to know. Cancel. Don't duplicate it. Just you need a terminal pointer, sir.
New session is coming, sir.
Okay.
New session is.
No. You have to type with the new tab will come actually. Just right click it once again. Hold on. Event log change reset terminal. Why new terminal is not coming for you? Usually get it from the PuTTY. Otherwise, you need to open for you need to install an another one. Okay, you just stop the server. I will start the server here. You run it from there.
Okay.
Otherwise, most of the students, some of them can access the same thing. Yeah. Now, yes, I just start the server from here. Command to run, I have shown you on, I have sent you the chat message box. From the chat message, you just take the, yes. So you just issue the command. Are you able to see the LED? LED now at present, it is off state only. Okay. Copy that and paste there. What happened?
It didn't copy, sir.
You press enter. Yeah, now LED is on here. This is the API call which you are sent from there. Yes. So here, yes, now the program, I will put the program there. So what I suggest you all is to practice various commands, not only just this patch command. You need to practice the get, put. But what happens is when you use the put command, if anybody puts put command, you cannot change it later. So the others will have get confusion if the two or three people you are using simultaneously. So just use the get command, and you can use the get command to get the state information, the pin informations, and you can use the patch command to make the state on and off. So like this, you can similarly, you please practice for your DHT, the DHT sensor, which is already connected to the pins of the Raspberry Pi, the same. So I will be making the system on available for you. So at least by next coming Tuesday, I expect all of you to submit. I will not call this as an assignment. You please write down the steps that you have made for your LED and DHT sensor to collect the data. Am I clear to you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Please send this, your steps which you have executed. See, I'm not forcing you to do here, but I'm just encouraging and you're informing you to at least to get the idea about how do you run this API calls and how do you write an API call program. So if you don't get this understanding, then it will be very difficult for you in the later stage too. I'm telling very sincerely. So please do, all of you do this exercise, and everybody has to submit. If I put an assignment, what happens is many of you are not doing it. So I would like to know who is interested and who is who is giving some efforts to do these things. So let me just check it out. So in that process, you'll also gain some knowledge and skills. How do you do this thing? So I will also get an idea about how you are serious about all these things. So that will be helpful for me to get an evaluation for your minor two. So that, yes. Any doubts here, please let me know.
Sir, I have a doubt about.
Yes, please. Yes, Subham.
So that Raspberry Pi actually connected to your private network, right? So in that case, how someone without the third party thing, how will be able to access that?
See, that is basically somebody else is trying now. Okay, anyway, you practice it. No, not a problem. Now, what is this third party? This is I am trying to, you are accessing the Raspberry Pi by using ng-rop, which is behind the firewall. So it is not a problem at all. That is not a problem which is there on the private network. Because I am giving the access for you, there is not a problem for you to access. If you are going to run it from a domain, okay. Let me just tell you. This one example is over now. You can also you can create your own domain name, and on your domain name you can give access rights to whom to authenticate and whom to not authenticate. You can also do that one. You can also run an MQTT protocol on this Raspberry Pi, so that two machines can run connect with each other and exchange. So in this program we are just using an API call. You can use the MQTT API call also with your username and password to have the authentication between two machines. See, if you understood this experiment clearly, you understood the robotics. I'm telling you, 90% of the robotics programming is over. If you understood this example thoroughly, I can assure you, if you are understood this API calls, building up the API calls thoroughly, robotics programming for the robots is done almost 90%. Only thing is, only 10% is remaining on the hardware devices to interface. That's all. This simple example, if you are able to get through, then I am sure that you are done the API programming, very crucial part in the IoTs. So I hope I am clear to you your doubt, or you are having still any further?
No, actually my doubt was that from the networking, we know that private IP address and the public IP address. So that's why I asked about that. So if I want to connect that, without that ng-rock that thing, then I have to connect that Raspberry Pi to the public IP address, right?
Right. I need to give a static IP, in fact. I have to specify a static IP.
Okay, from so static, that is not possible from my private, if I am connecting to my home Wi-Fi, right?
It is. I am connecting through my home Wi-Fi only now.
And that is for the tunneling we are getting from that ng-rock, right?
Yes, from the tunneling, the same thing. Because my Wi-Fi router is given from a service provider. If you can get your static IP from your service provider, that is fine. You have to pay for that.
Sir, I guess it is okay, Heroku or something, sir.
No, Heroku, that is a different thing. Subham, what I am trying to tell you here is, see, even now what I have connected my Raspberry Pi is through my home Wi-Fi network only.
Yes, sir.
But since that Wi-Fi network IP addresses keeps on changing every day, you not have a static IP for your service from your service provider for your Wi-Fi router. So if you request your service provider, who is your service provider?
That's Broadband, Alliance Broadband.
Okay, whoever it may be. So that service provider, if they are in a position to give static IPs, usually static IPs will be given by ISPs who are very much giants. Even your local cable operators cannot give you. Because static IP is one that telecom will be monitoring what is exactly happening with that IP. Okay. So that is a restriction will be there. If you are keep on pumping data to the internet, so you will be under a monitoring stage also. Don't worry about that. But if you get a permission from that for your scientific purpose, for your academic purpose, we do this. So usually, if you get a static IP, you put your static IP to your Wi-Fi router. You need not have NGROC, you need not have Heroku, you do not have other data publicity and all other stuff. Don't require this. So if you have a static IP, if you have a static IP, you just forward your so and so respective ports so that ports will govern the data that is to be followed for you. That will be having the security. You are opening only certain ports through which your data is going out and coming in. Hello, am I clear to you, Suman?
Yes, sir. Now it is clear.
Yeah. Any other queries, please? Please let me know. So this is one which you have done using PHP. Also, you can write a script like your JavaScript. Even through your JavaScript, also you can send a command to make the bulbs on and off. So in your own home, you can control. You can control your refrigerators, you can control your electric bulbs, your fans from your mobile phone. Like if you write these API calls, please. So your app should contain these API calls and you can monitor if they're on or off. And if they're on, you can off from your office also. So that's what people have done, so much of experiments and so much of things. The automation process of your IoTs. But the basic fundamental philosophy is this only. Other than that, nothing else. Any other doubts, please? Can you see my screen now? Even DHT sensor is connected. DHT sensor data is coming. Hello?
No, sir. The screen is not visible.
One second. Let me just present it. One second. Are you able to see the screen now?
Yes, sir. Now it's visible.
Yeah, a little bit delay is there. Now all my devices are connected, so a little bit delay will be there. Just bear with it. So this is the server which is running the Flask server. And this is the temperature humidity values. Both are running now. You can see the temperature humidity. One second, I'll run that one. Yes, so the temperature 28, humidity 66. Of course, it's not very accurate, but That those are the values coming from the device now. So you can play with this temperature, humidity, and the LEDs with the API calls and without API calls. You can do that one. So please let me know by Tuesday, and you have to submit that by Tuesday. What are the commands you have executed apart from the patch command, what I have given to you? So each one, each individual, please try to practice it and let me know. I understood the question, the exercise to be done for Tuesday. It will not take more than 10-15 minutes of your time, or at the maximum 1 hour out of these 4 days.
Can you please repeat once?
Okay. The question here is, there are two devices connected to the Raspberry Pi. One device is your DHT sensor and the other device is the LED. Are you able to see the screens, both the DHT and LED connected to the Raspberry Pi?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So now what I want here is, you have understood about this command now. Which command? The patch command to make LED on and off. Okay. Have you understood this command or not? The patch command of making the LED on and off. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Neha, I'm asking you, are you able to understand
what I'm trying to say? Yes, sir.
So what are the other HTTP methods that you need to see apart from patch command?
Sir, get.
Yes.
Put post.
So don't use put method and don't use delete method. You practice the get method for getting the information from the LED as well as getting the information from the DHT sensor. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Will you able to get DHT sensor data like this from the API call?
We'll need to write a method, I guess.
Yes, exactly. You need to write. Since you have written the methods only for pins of the LED, which is connected to the GPIO pin, you have not written the DHT sensor method for your GPIO pin. So please try to write that method, just a simple method to get the data from the DHT sensor, and you practice and let me know by Tuesday. Have you understood the question?
Sir, through the API only, sir, or we can create an app.root and display it on the HTML page or something.
If you want to display it on the HTML page, well and good. That will be most appreciable, so that you can write the display the value on the web page.
Oh, okay, sir.
If you can just run the command like what I have shown the command, that is also very good. Yeah, are you clear with this question, please? Neha, are you clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, please. Yes. Can you tell me what I am trying to do now? Are you able to see the screen, please?
Yes, sir.
the system become a little bit slow because so many applications are running there. So that you have to just little bit bear with that. RAM is only just 1 GB. It will come, but it will take a little bit time. Let me just stop this application for a while, then I'll get back. Okay, please let me know if you have any other queries. Just I'm trying to run the, instead of curl command, I'm going to run it from the web browser. So let me, my web browser is on, then I can run the command. So in the meantime, please let me know if you have any queries. Hello, am I online, please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Are you able to see screen? See the screen
no,
now?
Sir.
The HTTP on the browser? No? I'm just connecting it again, the Raspberry Pi. One second. Now, are you able to see the screen, Raspberry Pi screen? One second, it is getting on. It is a little bit slow, just it is loading. Just hold on. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes, sir.
So on the browser, instead of curl command, I'm just typing localhost colon 5000 slash pin slash one. So once I enter this, I'm just getting the ID information. That is what command did I type here, please? What method it has been executing?
Get, sir.
Get method, yes. That is what getting the ID information. You just type it and you just run it, you'll get the ID information. Now if I want to make the state on off on state from this, what command I have to use?
Post.
Instead of post, please
patch.
Yes, patch command. Use the patch command and let me know what you have done and what is the response you get it. Similarly, in order to get the DHT values like this on the browser also, you can get it, provided you write a method for the DHT sensor pins to be read in. So like in your Python program, you already written how the DHT values are going to be retrieved. Already you have written the Python program, if you remember, what pins I have used and what pins are connected there. So pins numbers are the same. I have not altered any circuit over there. So you try to fetch the data using the API call, using the RESTful API calls. So these are, so let me just wind up for today. We'll see it on Tuesday. Any queries here, please?